Here we go.
I mean, I don't even need to listen to that. Who streamed more, Madonna or Ariana Grande? Isn't Ariana Grande like got streaming tattooed on her neck somewhere? It's like she's like the streaming master. Who is better at karate, Mr. Miyagi or Ted Lasso? What's up, guys? My name is Paul Blair, professionally known as DJ White Shadow. I'm a Grammy-winning producer, songwriter, artist. Usually, my job is to write songs or to play songs for people, but today, my job is to show you how to use this incredible app called FanLabel. And I'm going to run this thing down and try and pick the best song, the one that streamed the most this week. First category is alternative. First one here is Handle by Porsche. I can't even read some of these. New kids out there today. In the Real World by My Morning Jacket. Dose of Her Smile by Scary Pool Party. Nobody Gets Me by Arkells. This is alternative? All this is alternative? This is what counts as alternative today? It's not like... It sounds pretty poppy. And Chaos, That Feeling by Lisa Ann. I know none of these songs. Not one of them. You say you love me, baby. That it's just been funny. So, generally speaking, I'm probably going to pick the wrong one just because I'm not as smart as I look, which isn't very smart at all. So here we go. I think that if I had to pick one of these, which I do contractually, here we go. Did I get it? Oh, third place. God, that sucked. Oh, there you go. Snap. This one is songs produced by yours truly, DJWS, Paul Blair. All right. First one's called Sexy Body. I've heard all these before, by the way. First one's called Sexy Body by Pitbull and Jennifer Lopez. This is a good song. This didn't get the shine that it deserved, that record. There was a couple good songs on that record. But like the album, there was politics going on with the album, and it didn't get pushed as hard as it should. There's like should have been like a big record. You know, right people, right time. I listen to it now, I'm like, oh, this is really well put together. It sounds good. It's like still timely, like I could play it in the club right now and it would do something. But why can't I play it in the club right now? Because nobody knows it, because the machine didn't put it into the lexicon. I don't run the machine. So, Why'd You Do That off the Star Is Born soundtrack by Lady Gaga. I wrote this with my friends Mark and Nick when we were on tour for Joanne. We were writing these songs for Star Is Born. Applause by Lady Gaga. This is one of the biggest Lady Gaga songs out there, I think. I can't remember the exact numbers for things, but I think it's a big one. As a matter of fact, the hook to that song got written, and we were throwing it away. She was throwing it away. She didn't want to use it. It was, like, not on the first pitch for the record. Whenever you make a song, album, you got to go in and pitch it to the label. So we were doing it at Jimmy's house. And Dave... You know, you're preparing in your mind, like, what to play and how to go through and what the story of the record is. It's like a giant presentation. And so when we went to Jimmy's house to play the record, I had to bring that record with me and play it out of, like, be like, there's one more song. And because she didn't want to include it. We played it because I knew it was the strongest song out of all of them. And so did Jimmy. And so we played it for the whole radio team and the promo team, and everybody was like, this is a great song. And then she was like, oh, this is a great song. So then we had to go back and record it. But it was just the, you know, memory is a funny thing, right? Like, it's like you tell yourself a story for like an amount of time, and like, this is my story, it's not her story. And I think she readily admit this, if we both have the same problem, but like, whenever she hates something, it's usually like a hit record, because like instinctively, like you know it's like really going to be really popular, and so you're like, ah, it's too right down the middle, like it is what it is, I hate that. And so then it's like, and I do the same thing, because that's why we get along, I think. But I think at the beginning, that's why it went into the back burner, because it was so pop, you know, like so obviously like big, that we were just both like, you know, whatever. Born This Way by Lady Gaga. This album just hit like 10 years this year. It's 10 years old. I was reading a poll where it was like the top 100 LGBTQ songs of all time, and it's number two behind I'm Coming Out by Diana Ross. So that's pretty. That's a pretty remarkable accomplishment. Like, when we were making it, I love that song. I mean, I love this. Every song on this list is, like, fantastic songs. But, like, when I was making it, it was like, this is so positive, this is so great, and, like, blah, blah, blah. When this gets out there, if we get a song about this on the radio, and I think that song was number one on Billboard for, like, 7 weeks or something like that. Maybe 11 weeks, like, longer than 1 week, you know? So it made this monster impact and was able to change, shift culture, even in a way that I can't comprehend sometimes. But I'll hear the production of that, and I probably have 100-plus versions of that song on my computer that I haven't opened since 2010. But I probably literally have 100 different versions of that song, different kind of iterations of where we were in the process. Some of them I loved, some of them I didn't like, some of them whatever. And, like, I'll hear that song. First of all, part of, like, the way that my mind works is I can listen to a song and only hear the hi-hats through the whole song. Like, it's the way that my brain works. It's always worked that way. Even if I listen to a Fleetwood Mac song, I can hear just the drum fills. Like, that's, it's part of, like, my whatever, weird gift. And so every time I listened to Born This Way for the longest time, all I could hear were these certain parts that I know are wrong, that I don't like, and it's all I could hear. So it was like I missed the whole entire point. You know what I mean? So it takes a long while to be like, shit, why did we settle on that synth instead of the other one that I can still hear from 10 years ago, you know? So anyway, but the message of the song and the presentation of the song are fantastic. You know what I mean? And Sex Dreams by Lady Gaga. We wrote this song in a hotel room for 14 hours. We stopped writing at 8 a.m. I was so tired that I was delirious. We were in Europe somewhere, and like in a room, like in a round table like this. And there was like so many times where I was like looking at Dave, because Dave has to record everything. So like Dave's the centerpiece. So we're all kind of like dancing around Dave because he's got to be stationary. And she's recording, and then it's an idea, and then it's another idea. And like when you're running through ideas, it can become exhausting. Like especially when everybody's got like different ideas. And then her process, once she has an idea, like she has to get it out. It's like a sneeze, you know? So it's like sometimes it's boom, and then sometimes it's like, well, and then sometimes it's like, holy cow, like this is like a marathon stretch of time trying to finish something. All right, so I got to pick which streamed the most last week. And I'm going to say it's between Applause and Born This Way. Son of a biscuit. I'm going to screw this up and everybody's going to make fun of me. Oh, I knew it was a second place. I thought that if I picked it, it was going to be first place, but it's not. How much is the difference? Oh, it's a lot more. Damn. I couldn't remember. I was trying to think about the numbers, if it actually streamed more, Applause streamed more, or Born This Way streamed more. I know Born This Way is a more popular song, but I think I read one time that Applause streamed more, so I was going off the data and not my instinct, which honestly, like any track, this sounds like a really probably stock answer, but for different reasons, you can't really pick a favorite, like picking a favorite kid. Sometimes one of them's your favorite, sometimes the other one's your favorite, sometimes neither of them are your favorite. But like, ArtPop as a whole record in general was a very weird time, like in life, and like a very weird time with things outside of the record. So it's like now I go back and look on it, you forget all the crap that was happening like during that time. But like there were 5 years where like I didn't even want to listen to it because like so much bad stuff was going on. Even though people enjoyed it and it was like so great to see people enjoying it and it was like really, you know, well received and like this great thing. But like from a standpoint of like sitting there, you know, I'm sure people at Burger King don't like Whoppers as much as the average, you know, person walking in to eat a hamburger, you know what I'm saying? Inside of your body, because of thousands of years of evolution, you tend to remember the bad things instead of the good things, right? For me, it takes a really long time to get to a point where it's like, oh, I just remember the good things. Because there was a lot of tears shed and a lot of, like, things going wrong, like, during that time. And I associated even really positive, happy songs with like a really negative time. A lot of sharks in the water, a lot of blood in the water, a lot of sharks in the water at that time. So it's a tough album. Quick pick. Oh, this is tough. I feel like some people are going to be upset about this one. If this is NSYNC, will Timberlake be upset that he, oh, here we go. Oh, I was only thinking because I didn't want JT to be upset. Come on. What are we talking about? Married Life from Up streamed number one and Raiders March streamed number five. What are you doing out there, streaming world? You're obviously living wrong. It's like one of the greatest film songs of all time. I'm going to play this 500 times today just to get these numbers up. All right, let's see what else is on this thing. Leaderboards? Marketplace? It's going to take me 20 years of playing FanLabel based on my number four choices to be able to buy anything on this thing. But Spotify Premium. Oh, I like this. This is cool. My royalty numbers are down. Number four. I'm going to have to play this thing. Listen, here's the upside of this whole thing. You can beat me at this game. All right, which one streamed the most last week? Hip hop. All right, here we go. Okay, I Believe You by Moneybagg, yo. All right, I don't even know what I don't know what this is. I'm saving that one. That, just because it's called Balls to the Wall and Fire. All right. $5 to anybody know what that sample is from. Slime Life Shouty. Future. Okay. Only use it for music. My take on go stupid all over that net like a volley. See, here's another thing. Maxo Cream's the weirdest out of all these, and he's the only one that I really like at the beginning. Like, I'm like, oh, Maxo Cream's dope because he's always coming like left of center of everything. But based on name only, I would either pick Moneybagg or the Slime Life Shorty record with Future. I think that the Moneybagg one's probably the one. Okay, here we go. Here we go. I'm going to pick this one. Oh, second. What's first? Slime Life. See? And 40% of the people picked Moneybagg again. They must be paying more money to get more streams for this Future record. The thing about the music business is that you can work. It's not like a normal job where you like go into work, you put in 8 hours, you put in your all, you try your very hardest, like you create X amount of product, and then at the end of the week, you get paid and recognized for that product in some way, shape, or form. In the music business, you can be the best musician, have the best idea, work the very hardest, day up, sun down, and you cut your tree down in the forest and nobody hears it. You know what I mean? Because some guy in an office had beef with another guy in an office that you have nothing to do with. So it's like, in order for your product to reach consumption level, recognition level, there's so many things that go into it besides being a good musician. And so when people ask me questions about like, oh, what do? I want to get in the music business. I was like, go study behavioral science. Like, skip the piano lessons, go study behavioral science. Because like, that's 90% of it. The reason why Weeknd didn't win a Grammy last year has nothing to do with the fact that he had the best album out. Like, arguably, one of the greatest albums of the entire year didn't get one Grammy Award. Why? I don't know why that is. I have no idea why he didn't get nominated. But there's a reason, and it's not because his music was bad or didn't deserve it. You know what I mean? So that's a very taxing environment to have to work in every day. Like, you meet people that are in the music business, people tell me, which in my like later years, like, you're so unaffected by things. Or you're like, so like you don't ask anybody any questions, or you don't tell people about like stuff. And it's like this weird defense mechanism that I've built up over the last like 10 years where I'm just like, whatever, man. Because if you get attached to things, oh, you know, your business partner of 15 years or this guy that you put on here, like, just totally like left. Like, or you get stuck holding the bag here, or like, you know, this, you work with this person forever and they don't give a shit anymore. You know what I mean? Like, or you put in all this work, you made 17 versions of the song for this person and did exactly everything they asked. They turn to the label, now the label doesn't want it. It's like if you can't like just that off, if you can't Barry Sanders it all the way down to the end zone, like you're in trouble. Like you'll die. You'll fall apart because like you have to have the, like the thickest skin of all time. And to take nothing personal because it's not personal. It's like you have to love it for doing it. You have to love doing it and failing as much as you have doing it and succeeding. If you love the success, bail out now because it's like you'll never. That's not guaranteed. You could literally be Elton John level talented and never leave your bedroom. It's got nothing to do with it. I still don't know if I'm to that point, so it's hard every day still. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, it's like you've had being mindful of it is like, you know, a constant battle, I think. Enough of that depressing talk. Let's game it up. 1993 songs. Hard Working Man, Brooks and Dunn. Mm. Bricks and done on fire. I could have barely gotten by. I love country music. Oh, what time's up? It was Brooks and Dunn. I was so excited about Brooks and Dunn that, like, here's my thing. I can say this now that I got that excited about it, but I probably would not have picked Brooks and Dunn. But I do really like Brooks and Dunn. That's exciting. Damn it. I'm like earning no fan label dollars today. Who would let this guy out of the box with this name? Johnny Orlando is literally the worst name for a singer ever. You can put that on there and put that out. Because that can't be his real name. I stick by my choice. Daniel Sky, thumbs up. Johnny Orlando. Sorry. Your name sucks. But I mean, White Shadow sucks too. It's not like it's like, you know, it's whatever. I'm sure he's a really charming guy, nice guy. But anyway, back to the drawing board with that name. This is the best thing about FanLabel is discovering people because I would never listen to OMB Bloodbath, but this is like a dope song too. This is, you know what, this in 1993, this would be like really bad, like baby making music. Like you'd be like, it's like, you know what I mean? Like hip hop is hip hop, you know? And it's like you putting this like this is considered hip hop now, but it's like. All right, so the two songs I like with this Ryan Trey one and this OMB Bloodbath, and it's not gonna work. But here we go. Here we go. Fourth place. This is good. I wouldn't consider this hip hop. I just picked the only hip hop song in the whole hip hop category. All right, pressure's on again. All right, here we go. Here we go. Oh, little Tekka. I knew that was the big one. That's the first quick pick I won because it's the only one I knew. They sound like the same song, don't they? Where's one stop and the other begin? All right, little Tekka. I'm just thinking, you know, like they should with the implementation of the internet and the creation of music, they should restructure like what their name, what like categories. Like, there should be a technically shitty category. Like, there's just, like, this music is technically shitty, but for some reason people like it. We're ranking these. You know what I mean? Because, like, that little Tekka song is barely a song. If you've spent time, like, learning music or, like, actually giving a shit about song structure, like, that doesn't even qualify as, like, music. It's just, like, a feeling. So it's, like, there should be, like, a new category. It's, like, not music music. And little Tekka. Usually, like, if you have a little in front of your name, it'd probably, like, you'd automatically be qualified for that category. It's based on name alone. Here we go. Lady Hawk, Tegan, and Sarah. What? Ah! Oh! As soon as I heard the banjos, I was out. No, thanks. Oh, there's a lot of people out there that like the banjo. Steve Martin. Oh, John coming out. He's got a mask on. He's got a face. He's got a mask on on the album cover. Progressive EJ. I'm gonna pick this one. Fourth place. Fourth place is my spot. Elton John was the number one streaming record out of these by that far of a landslide. I'm heaven, let's just say that's no Crocodile Rock. Oh, no! Damn it. I was going to pick Schoolboy Q as well, I feel like. You know, back before anybody knew Kendrick Lamar was, and we were working on ArtPop, Gaga was like, I want to work with a rap artist on one of these things. And I was like, Schoolboy Q or Kendrick Lamar. Those are my two choices. And Schoolboy Q had this mixtape out, which was bonkers. And then Kendrick got signed to Interscope, so they ended up working together. And I missed it. I had to go finish another thing. And so she went in with Kendrick by himself. Like, he hadn't even put out a record yet. They were in the studio all day, and I was so mad. I think that in my entire career, the one thing that I can really point to and say I'm sad that I missed it was the day that Kendrick Lamar came. Before he put out one song, he hadn't put out, like, anything monstrous yet. That's why the song never came out, because I wasn't there to champion it. Oh, 14%. I guess this tells you, like, why I never took a job with a label, huh? I am not a shining star in the A&R industry. I'm going to keep trying. Maybe I can get better. Thanks for playing. Thanks for listening. Hope that I taught you a little bit about how not to play FanLabel, as well as how to play FanLabel. Technically, running through the buttons, I think I taught you how. But via choice, I think I taught you not how to do it. Don't go with my instincts. Go with your instincts. Be a winner, not a loser like me. All right, thanks.